Hello friends, welcome to the channel Gyan of IAS. Today we are going to look at how Taiwan is beating the COVID-19. If you find this video helpful in any manner, I request you to kindly subscribe to this channel. As of 29th March 2020, the total number of confirmed cases in the world have crossed 7 lakh and more than 33,000 deaths have been recorded. On the other hand, in Taiwan, the number of confirmed cases is only 298 with only 2 deaths so far. These low numbers highlight the success of Taiwan in fighting this pandemic, even though it is highly vulnerable to COVID-19. Now let's look at the vulnerabilities of Taiwan. Taiwan is among the most likely country to see a rapid spread of the virus due to its proximity to China. It sits just 130 km off the coast of mainland China. Hundreds of thousands of Taiwanese work in mainland China and they do extensive travel across the Taiwan Strait. Another factor is Beijing's One China policy. China considers Taiwan as part of its territory that must one day be reunified with the mainland. According to China, Taiwan has no right to participate in international diplomacy, and due to Chinese pressure, Taiwan has been denied membership to most international organizations, including the WHO. Another factor is its population. Although it has a small population of 23 million, but the population density is quite high at 650 persons per kilometer. This makes Taiwan vulnerable to rapid spread of virus. Now let's look at reasons for Taiwan's success in staying ahead of the curve in this pandemic. These are early response, pervasive screening, contact tracing and comprehensive testing, adroit use of technology, steep penalties for non-compliance, quality compulsory single-payer healthcare system, trust in government and social solidarity. Now let's look at these factors in detail. The first one is learning from the past experience of battling the SARS outbreak in 2003 and the swine flu outbreak in 2009. The government passed legislation to facilitate a more effective response to future outbreaks. Under Taiwan's Communicable Disease Control Act, special powers to integrate data and track people are allowed during a crisis. National Health Command Center was also established to coordinate efforts. The next factor is extensive preparations. Systems, processes, and resources were allocated for a comprehensive response plan to tackle a rapid onset epidemic. Key elements of this program include transparency, information sharing, staffing agencies with relevant experts, inter-agency cooperation, coordinating the efforts of government labs with hospitals and other medical facilities across the island. Next factor is early proactive response. The response was remarkably quick to initial reports from Wuhan. Taiwanese officials activated the emergency plan on January 20th. Border controls were put in place to check passengers for symptoms. Taiwan restricted the entry for foreign travelers from the most affected regions. Those who were allowed in Taiwan, they were tracked by officials. Legislature passed a special bill allocating $2 billion to fund containment and control efforts. The government promised compensation for furloughed workers and tax breaks for companies affected. Paid leave for caregivers and the sick people was also given. Manufacturing of essential equipment like face masks and personal protective equipment was given emphasis. Power of Taiwan's small medium enterprises was used to increase the capacity to produce an average of 9.2 million masks per day. Soldiers were also sent to work at mask factories to ramp up production. Taiwan also formed protocols for tracing sources of infection. They have been successful in reducing the risk of transmission in settings such as schools, hospitals, and transportation systems. They have set price limits on masks and ration them using individuals' national health insurance cards and an online ordering mechanism. Taiwan officials from the beginning of the viral outbreak did a very detailed mapping of who got it from whom and were able to stop a lot of transmissions early. The officials integrated Taiwan's national health insurance database with its immigration and customs database. This enabled the government to track the 14-day travel histories and symptoms of its citizens. Nearly all of the citizens have an identifying national health insurance card. All hospitals, clinics, and pharmacies were given access to this information in order to identify individuals for testing. A compulsory single-payer system established in 1995 that provides comprehensive medical services to all legal residents has been a key factor in arresting the rise of infections. The foreign visitors are asked to scan a QR code that takes them to an online health declaration form where they provide contact information and symptoms. The hospitals have managed to reduce internal transmissions between patients and medical staff. The next factor is isolation of infected and high-risk people. People placed under quarantine are given government-issued mobile phones and they are monitored with calls and GPS. Also, government has relied on old-fashioned face-to-face check-ins. And the households are grouped into wards and a chief is named for each ward. Authorities will ask the chief to go and check on quarantined person and to bring them some food. They are trying to be nice to people, otherwise they will have to hide their symptoms. Another factor is strict penalties. Penalties for non-compliance with the temporary orders are steep. Profiteering of prevention products like masks or spreading false information about COVID-19 can bring a penalty of years in jail and fines over $100,000. For example, one couple was fined $10,000 for breaking a 14-day quarantine rule. Three Hong Kong visitors who disappeared for a week were tracked down and fined $2,350 each and transferred to designated quarters for medical isolation. The next factor is plugging of gaps. During the SARS outbreak, the foreign workers often fell through the cracks because information was circulated only in Chinese. This has been rectified now. An estimated 52,000 persons are working illegally on the island. Their potential for transmitting the virus is significant. So the Taiwan government is focusing on them, especially the caregivers who are working without documentation. They have incentivized people to be truthful on their declaration forms. If one is placed in high-risk group, the government will help them to get care. Next factor is use of technology. Use of integrated databases of Taiwan's National Health Insurance Database and its Immigration and Customs Database to identify high-risk people. Detailed mapping of infections using IT. Taiwanese officials have used big data to estimate the region's supply of masks, negative pressure isolation rooms, and other health provisions. Use of QR code and online health declaration form to get contact information and symptoms from foreign visitors. Use of government issued mobile phones and GPS to monitor isolated people. Next is social and political factors. The traditional Chinese view of politics assumes a relatively larger role in society for the government. The idea of mutual solidarity inherent in the Confucian value of social harmony could help Taiwanese put up with many inconveniences of measures that are needed to reduce the aggregate infection rate. People are more willing to accept government orders. There seems to be more of a willingness to place the community and society needs over individual liberty. Taiwan has been under China's threat constantly, which has raised social consciousness about collective action. Long tradition of elevating scholars and experts to the highest levels of government is also an important factor. President Tsai Ing-wen, who has a PhD from London School of Economics, the current vice president is a highly regarded epidemiologist. He was appointed Minister of Health in the middle of 2003 outbreak. Another important factor is commitment to transparency. The government has gone to great lengths to keep citizens well informed on every aspect of the outbreak. This includes through daily press conferences and active presence on social media. For example, on March 15, Vice President posted a lengthy analysis of international coronavirus incidence and mortality rates on Facebook. Health Minister warned that people must not grow complacent, saying that local transmissions are inevitable and we must make preparations as though we are facing a more serious situation. The Taiwan's government has nurtured public trust by its actions and its transparency. Friends, this video ends here. If you find this video helpful in any manner, please like the video, subscribe to the channel, and also provide your suggestions in the comment section. Thank you.